17 to 20. Jesus looked towards heaven and prayed. Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, so that your Son may glorify you. For you granted him authority over all people, that he may give eternal life to those you have given him. Now this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I have brought you glory on earth by finishing the work you gave me to do. Now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began. I have revealed you to those you have given me out of the world. They were yours. You gave them to me. And they have obeyed your word. Now they know that everything you have given me comes from you. I have given them the words that you gave me, and they accepted them. They knew with confidence that I came from you. They believe that you sent me. I pray for them. I'm not praying for the world, but for those you have given me. For they are yours. All I have is yours, and all you have is mine. And glory has come to me through them. I will remain in the world no longer, but they are still in the world, and I am coming to you. Oh, Holy Father, protect them by the power of your name, that name that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them and kept them safe. None have been lost, except the one doomed to destruction, so that Scripture may be fulfilled. I am coming to you now. But I say these things while I'm still in the world, so that they may have the full measure of my joy within them. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them. They are not of the world any more than I am of the world. My prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world any more than I am of the world. Sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. And as you have sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. And for them I sanctify myself, so that they too may be truly sanctified. My prayer is not for them alone. I also pray for those who will believe in me through their message. That all of them may be one, Father. Just as is you are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity, and then the world will know that you sent. sent me and have loved them, even as you have loved me. Father, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am and to see my glory, the glory that you had for me because you loved me before the creation of the world. Righteous Father, though the world does not know you, I know you. And they know that you have sent me. I have made you known. Continue to make you known, so that the love that you have for me may be in them, and that I myself may be in them. After Jesus had finished praying, he went with his disciples and crossed the Kidron Valley. And on the other side there was a garden, and so Jesus and his disciples entered it. Now, Judas, who had betrayed Jesus, knew of the place, because Jesus often met with his disciples there. And so he came to the garden, guiding a detachment of soldiers and officials from the chief priests and the Pharisees. And they were carrying torches and lanterns and weapons. And Jesus, knowing all that was going to happen to him, came out to them and said, "Who is it you are looking for?" "Jesus of Nazareth," they said. And Judas, the traitor, was standing there with them. Jesus replied, "I am he." And then Jesus said, "I am he." Well, they withdrew and fell to the ground. Again, Jesus asked them, "Who is it you are looking for?" "Jesus of Nazareth," they replied again. "I have already told you that I am he. If you are looking for me, let these men go." And this happened so that Jesus' words would be fulfilled. "I have not lost one of those you have given me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it and struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his right ear. Now the servant's name was Malchus. And Jesus commanded him, "Put your sword away. Shall I not drink the cup my father has given me?" And then the detachment of soldiers with their commander, Jewish officials, arrested Jesus. They bound him and brought him to Annas, the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest. Now, Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jewish leaders that it would be good if one man would die for the people. Simon Peter and another disciple entered and followed Jesus. And because the other disciple was known to the high priest, he went in with Jesus into the high priest's courtyard. But Peter had to wait out at the door. So the disciple who was known to the high priest went back, spoke to the servant girl who was at the duty that night, and brought Peter in. And the servant girl said,
servants and the officials had gathered around a fire to keep warm. And so Peter stood with them and warmed himself as well. Now, meanwhile, the high priest was questioning Jesus about his disciples and his teaching. I have spoken openly to the world, he said. I've always taught in synagogues and in temples where all the Jews gathered. I said nothing in secret. Why question me? Why not ask those who have heard me? Surely they can tell you what I've said. When he said this, one of the officials standing nearby slapped him in the face. Is that how you answer the high priest? And Jesus replied, if I have said something wrong, testify to what is wrong. But if I speak the truth, why do you strike me? And Annas bound Jesus and sent him off to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now, meanwhile, Simon Peter was still warming himself by the fire, and one of those standing there said, Hey, you aren't one of his disciples too, are you? And Peter again denied it. Oh, no, I'm not. Then one of the servants of the high priest, who was a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, she challenged him, saying, did I see you with him in the garden? Again, Peter denied it. And at once, an alarm went off in his bedroom. A rooster began to crow. Now, the Jewish leaders brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the palace of the Roman governor. Now, at this stage, it was early morning, and so to avoid ceremonial uncleanness, they did not enter the palace because they wanted to eat the Passover. And so Pilate went out to speak to them. What charges are you bringing against this man? He asked. If he were not a criminal, we wouldn't have handed him over to you, they replied. Well, then take him and judge him by your own law, Pilate said. But we have no right to execute anyone, they replied. So Pilate went back into the palace and summoned Jesus and asked him, are you the king of the Jews? And Jesus replied, is that your own idea? Or did others talk to you about me? Am I a Jew? No. Your own chief priests and people brought you to me. Now, tell me, what is it you have done? Jesus replied, my kingdom is not of this world. You know, if it were, my servants would have fought to prevent my arrest from the Jewish leaders, but now my kingdom is from another place. So you are a king then.
say I have a king. In fact, the reason why I was born and came into this world is to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me. What is truth? And with that, Pilate went out to the Jews gathered there and said, I find no basis for charges against this man, but because it is your custom for me to release a prisoner at the time of your Passover, would you like me to release the King of the Jews? But they shouted, no, not him! Release Barabbas! Now Barabbas, involved in an insurrection. And so Pilate had Jesus flogged. And the soldiers, they twisted together a crown made out of thorns and put it on his head. And they clothed him in a purple robe. And they went up to him again and again, saying, oh, hail, King of the Jews! And they slapped him in his face. Then Pilate went out to the Jews gathered there again and said, look, I am bringing him out to you again to tell you that I find no basis for a charge against him. As soon as Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, and Pilate said, here is the man. As soon as the chief priests and their officials saw Jesus, they shouted, crucify! Crucify! Pilate said, you take him and crucify him. As for me, I find no basis for charges against him. And the chief priest said, we have a law, and according to that law, this man must die because he claimed to be the Son of God. Went back into the palace and asked Jesus, where do you come from? Where do you come from? Jesus gave him no answer. Do you refuse to speak to me? Don't you know that I have the power to either free you or crucify you? And Jesus replied, you would have no power if it were not given to you from above. Therefore, the one who has handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin. This Pilate, from this point on, tried to free Jesus. But the people kept shouting, take any! No, but the chief priest said, if you release this man, you are no friend of Caesar. Anyone who claims to be a king opposes Caesar. When Pilate heard this, he brought Jesus out sat down on the judge's seat at a place known as the stone pavement, which in Aramaic is Gabbatha. It was the day of preparation of the Passover. It was about noon. "Here is your king," Pilate said. But the people shouted, "Take him away! Take him away! Crucify him! Shall I crucify your king?" Soldiers took Jesus and made him carry his own cross. And they came to the place of the skull, which in Aramaic is called Golgotha. And there they crucified him. And with him, two others, one on his right and one on his left, Pilate had prepared and fastened a notice to go on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." And many Jews saw the sign because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city. And the sign was written in Aramaic, Latin, and Greek. Now, the chief priests of the Jews protested to Pilate, saying, "Do not write 'the King of the Jews,' but that this man claimed to be the King of the Jews." Pilate said, "What I have written, I have written." Now the soldiers who had crucified Jesus, they took Jesus' clothes and they divided it into four shares, one for each of them, with the undergarments remaining. Now this garment was seamless, woven into one piece from top to bottom. So they said, "Let's not tear it. Let's cast lots to see who'll get it." Now this happened to fulfill the scripture, which said, "They cast lots for my garment and divided up my clothing." And so that's what the soldiers did. And near the cross of Jesus stood his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. And when Jesus saw his mother, along with the disciple whom Jesus loved, standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that time on, this disciple took her into his arms. Later, knowing everything had been finished, and so that scripture may be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." Now there was a jar of wine vinegar nearby, and so they took a sponge and soaked it, and then put the sponge on the stalk of a hyssop plant and lifted it to Jesus' lips. And after
preparation for the Passover, and the next day was a special Sabbath. And because the chief priests did not want the bodies left up on the crosses during the Sabbath, they went to Pilate and asked that their legs be broken and the bodies be taken down. Therefore, the soldiers went and broke the legs of the first man crucified next to Jesus, and then broke the legs of the other. But when they came to Jesus, they saw that he was already dead. They did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, causing a sudden flow of blood and water. The man who saw this gives testimony, and his testimony is true. He knows, he speaks the truth, and he testifies so that you too may believe. These things happened so that the scriptures may be fulfilled. None of his bones shall be broken. And as another scripture says, they will look on the one they have pierced. Joseph of Arimathea went to Pilate and asked for his permission to take Jesus' body. Now, Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly, because he was afraid of the Jewish leaders. And so, with Pilate's permission, he came and took Jesus' body. He was accompanied by Nicodemus, the man who had earlier met with Jesus at night. And Nicodemus brought a mixture of aloes and myrrh, around 34 kilos. And then they took Jesus' body, and together they wrapped his body with the spices in strips of linen, according to Jewish burial customs. Now, the place where Jesus was crucified, near there was a garden. And in that garden, a new tomb in which no one had yet been laid. Because it was the day of preparation, and since the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there.
first day of the week, very early in the morning while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb.
She saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. She ran to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken my Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him."
And so Simon Peter and the other disciple ran for the tomb. They were both running. One of them, the one Jesus loved, arrived at first. He bent down and looked into the tomb and saw the strips of linen lying there, but he didn't go in. And then Simon Peter came along and he went right into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen as well as the burial cloth that had wrapped Jesus' head in. It was lying right where it was, and separate from the linen. And then, finally, the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, entered the tomb. He saw and believed. Now, they still didn't realize from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. And then Simon Peter and the other disciple went back to where they were living. Mary Magdalene stood behind the tomb, weeping. She bent down to look into the tomb and saw two angels dressed in white sitting where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. And they asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" She said, "They have taken my Lord away, and I don't know where they have put him." And she turned around and saw Jesus standing there. But she didn't realize that it was Jesus. And he said to her, "Woman, why are you crying?" She said, now thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have taken my Lord away, tell me where you have put the body and I will go get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." And she turned to see him. She cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. And Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father. But go and tell my brothers, I am ascending to my Father and to your Father, to my God, and to your God." And so Mary ran back and told Simon Peter and the other disciple, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them all that he had spoken to her. Now, on the evening
first day of the week. The disciples were all gathered together in one place, with the doors locked for fear of the Jews. And Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I am sending you." And then he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. Anyone's sins you forgive, they are forgiven. Anyone you don't forgive, they're not forgiven." Now, Thomas, named Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus arrived. And so the disciples, they ran and told him, once again, all gathered together, and this time Thomas was with them. And again, though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "My hands, reach out your hands and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." And Thomas said, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said, "You believe because you have seen. Oh, but blessed are those who have not seen and yet have." Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples that are not recorded in this book. But these things are recorded.